Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Troop by Nick Cutter. Read by Corey Brill.
For my brother, Graham. Adults are obsolete children, Dr. Seuss. This head is for the beast. It's a gift. William Golding, Lord of the Flies. Part 1. The Hungry Man. Headline from the Weird News Network, online edition, October 19th. The Hungry Man of Prince County by Huntington Mulvaney. Fearsome news, dear readers, from one of our loneliest outposts, the tiny fishing community of Lower Montague, Prince Edward Island, a forlorn, foreboding spike of rock projecting into the Atlantic Ocean. The perfect location for devilry, methinks. Thankfully for you, we have eyes and ears everywhere. We see all, we hear all. Sadie Atkins, waitress at the Diplomat Diner in Lower Montague, had her late model Chevrolet truck stolen from the restaurant's lot last night by an unnaturally emaciated thief. Atkins placed a call to our toll-free tip line after her entreaties to local deputy dogs were cruelly and maliciously rebuffed, deemed, and we quote, ludicrous and insane. "I know who stole my damn truck," Atkins told us. "Starvin' Marvin." An unidentified male with close-cropped hair and baggy clothing entered the Diplomat at 9 p.m. According to Atkins, the man was in a severe state of malnourishment. "Skinny? You wouldn't believe," Atkins told our intrepid truth-gatherers. "Never in my life have I seen a man so wasted away, but hungry." Atkins reports that the unidentified male consumed 5 Hungry Man breakfast platters, each consisting of 4 eggs, 3 buttermilk pancakes, 5 rashers of bacon, sausage links, and toast. "He ate us out of eggs," Atkins said, "just kept shoveling it in and asking for more. His belly must have swelled up tight as a drum. When I came back with his 3rd platter, or maybe it was his 4th, I caught him eating the napkins, ripping them out of the dispenser, chewing and swallowing them." The unidentified man paid his bill and left. Shortly thereafter, Atkins went outside to find her truck stolen, yet another malicious indignity. "I can't say I was too surprised," she said. "The man seemed desperate in every way a man can possibly be desperate." She fell silent again before adding one final grisly detail. "I could hear something coming from inside him. I'm saying, under his skin. I know that sounds silly." The unidentified man remains at large. Who is he? Where did he come from? The people who know, and longtime readers know who we're talking about, the government, the Secret Service, the Templars, the Illuminati, the usual shady suspects, aren't forthcoming with info. But we are beating the bushes and scouring secret files, investigating every legitimate tip that arrives at our tip line. Something evil is afoot in sleepy Prince County. No man can be that hungry. If you like this article, you may also enjoy Cheeseburger Kills Space Alien, Beelzebub Captured by GIs in Iraq, Hellspawn Baby Runs Amok in Tupelo, El Chupacabra Drains Toddler's Blood in Public Park. Chapter 1. Eat, 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 eat. The boat skipped over the waves, the drone of its motor trailing across the Gulf of St. Lawrence. The moon was a bone fish hook in the clear October sky. The man was wet from the spray that kicked over the gunwale. The outline of his body was visible under his drenched clothes. He easily could have been mistaken for a scarecrow, left carelessly unattended in a farmer's field, stuffing torn out by scavenging animals. He'd stolen the boat from a dock at North Point, at the farthest tip of Prince Edward Island, reaching the dock in a truck he'd hotwired in a diner parking lot. Christ, he was hungry, He'd eaten so much at that roadside diner that he'd ruptured his stomach lining. The contents of his guts were right now leaking through the split tissue into the crevices between his organs. He wasn't aware of that fact, though, and wouldn't care much anyway in his current state. It felt so good to fill the empty space inside of him. But it was like dumping dirt down a bottomless hole. You could throw shovelful after shovelful, yet it made not the slightest difference. 50 miles back, he'd stopped at the side of the road, having spotted a raccoon carcass in the ditch. Torn open, spine gleaming through its fur, it had taken great effort not to jam the transmission collar into park, go crawling into that ditch, and he hadn't done that. He was still human, after all. The hunger pangs would stop, he assured himself. His stomach could only hold so much. Wasn't that, like, a scientific fact? This was unlike anything he'd ever known. Images zipped through his head, slideshow style, his favorite foods lovingly presented, glistening and overplumped and too perfect, ripped from the glossy pages of Bon Appetit, a leering parody of food, freakishly sexual, hyper-stylized, and lewd. He saw cherries spilling from a wedge of flaky pie, each one nursed to a giddy plumpness, looking like a mess of avulsed bloodshot eyeballs dolloped with a towering cone of whipped cream. Flash. A porterhouse thick as a dictionary, shank bone winking from fat marbled meat charred to crackly doneness, a pat of herbed butter melting over top, the meat almost sighs as the knife hacks through it, cooked flesh parting with the deference of smoothly oiled doors. Flash. 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 What wouldn't he eat now? He yearned for that raccoon. If it were here now, he'd rip the hardened rags of sinew off its tattered fur. He'd crush its skull and sift through the splinters for its brain, which would be as delicious as the nut meat of a walnut. Why hadn't he just eaten the fucking thing? Would they come for him? He figured so. He was their failure, a human blooper reel, but also the keeper of their secret. And he was so toxic. At least that's what he overheard them say. He didn't wish to hurt anyone. The possibility that he may already have done so left him heartsick. What was it that Edgerton had said? If this gets out, it'll make Typhoid Mary look like Mary Poppins. He was not an evil man. He'd simply been trapped and had done what any man in his position might do. He'd run. And they were coming for him. Would they try to capture him, return him to Edgerton? He wondered if they'd dare do that now. He wasn't going back. He'd hide and stay hidden. He doubled over, nearly spilling over the side, hunger pangs gnawing into his gut. He blinked stinging tears out of his eyes and saw a dot of light dancing on the horizon. An island? A fire? Natural Resources Canada, Geographical Survey Report, Falstaff Island, Prince Edward Island. Situated 15 kilometers off the northern point of the main landmass, highest point, 452 meters above sea level, 10.4 kilometers in circumference. Two beachheads, one on the west-facing headland, one on the northeastern outcrop. A granite cliff dominates the northern shore, dropping some 200 meters into a rocky basin. Terrain consists of hardy brush grasses, shrubs, jimson weed, staghorn sumac, and lowland blueberry. Vegetation growth stunted by high saline content in the island's water table. Topsoil eroded by high winds and precipitation. Home to thriving avian, marine, mammal, reptile, and insect life. Pelicans, gulls, and other seafowl congregate on the northern cliffs. Chief stocks, salmon, cod, brim, sea bass. Sea lions bask off the island in the summer, drawing pods of orcas. Small but hardy indigenous populations of raccoon, skunk, porcupine, and coyote. These specimens are likewise smaller and leaner than their mainland counterparts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.